Next up is Justin Fishkin, and his story is every bit as inspiring. Local motors first came on the radar for many of you when they 3D printed a car. You think, okay, 3D printing a car, why would you want to do that? But the story is much grander than that, and in the last few months, they've created an electric autonomous vehicle called Ollie. My colleague Jim Anderton got a ride in Ollie at IMTS in Chicago last month, and his comment was, if you can't get excited about technology like this, you really need to check your pulse. It is exciting. And what Justin's going to talk about is a vision for automotive that's actually far beyond that. So Justin, please come on up.
Hello, thanks for having me. Just first of all, how many people have heard of locomotives? I always sort of ask that so I get a gauge. Okay, good. What I want to talk about today is, you've heard about co-creation, and John Miller was talking about that earlier. This is the first example of co-creation. I was at a Siemens event in Boston recently, and I played a couple videos, and I sort of took a crowd vote. And Donna Wright from Siemens came up to me after and said, you got to start with the end. And so this is a video about one of our, so it gives a little hint of our vision for the future. Actually, can we go back a slide and play the video? Awesome, thank you.
This is the end. The end of the assembly line. The end of the showroom floor. The end of the smooth-talking salesman. The hard sell. The soft sell. The oversized inflatable gorillas. And overinflated inventory that absolutely must go. This is the end of the junkyard full of old cars leaching chemicals into the ground. Born from the concept of cradle-to-cradle manufacturing. Printed in front of you to be the exact car you want. Melted, deconstructed, and rebuilt to be the next car you need. This is where vehicle manufacturing as we know it comes to an end. And where vehicle manufacturing, as it should be, begins.
So we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But it all starts with CAD. It all starts right at the beginning with Solid Edge. And Siemens PLM has been a great partner of ours since the founding of the company. We are locomotives. And we exist to shape the future, and that's a big statement, but it speaks to what John Hayes said earlier. It's not just about automotive for us. We think there's a better way. It's important to understand, first off, that we're innovators and manufacturers. There's a lot of companies out there that can innovate but aren't making things, or and then on the flip side, mass manufacturers who aren't doing a lot of innovation. Some exist right in the middle, but we make that our where we live every day. And this is something that we speak about at Locomotives a lot, is the unrivaled capacity to make the improbable come to life. And if we can inspire people by bringing them into our process, we're able to rapidly innovate and rapidly bring to market new technologies. And we started with the vehicle because it's the most complex system of them all. It's a $2 trillion industry. And if you look at a car today, it's got upwards of 20,000 components that you're bringing together. And it could come, if it's made in Detroit or Ulsan, Korea, or in Japan, you're bringing in sometimes as many as 500 suppliers from all over the world, many local, and then you're distributing those after you make a million units out to your dealer network, and they may sit on lots as inventory and never get sold, or it's a massive system. So our founder, Jay Rogers, who's actually spoken at this event in the past, he comes from an automotive background. His grandfather was the president of Cummins Diesel. I was walking through the airport yesterday. I don't know if anyone saw that Cummins Diesel race car sitting there, but it made me think of this. Jay. He's a really interesting guy. He was first day of Stanford Business School, he met a Marine who told him, why are you here if you've already started a business in the past. You know, if you want to be a leader, join the Marines. This was 1999, and next day he signed up for the Marines, which is, you know, I always ask him about that. It seemed like a pretty huge decision to make, obviously pre-September 11th, but he ended up being posted in Iraq, where two of his buddies died in a military vehicle that was maybe 30 years old. They weren't sure, but it was old. And he had this realization that, A, we're here for oil, which has been driven by the fact that vehicles are made to work everywhere. And B, it takes too long for vehicles to come to market, for new technologies to protect my buddies, whether it's in the military industrial complex or in consumer passenger vehicles. And so he had been a student of open source software, Linux. There was a time when Bill Gates said, give me five programmers or six programmers, I'll put all the hackers in the world out of business. We know he was wrong. Most of the supercomputers in the world now run on open source. So Jay had been studying that in college. And he had the first sort of, he had just started to see the beginnings of open source hardware in threadless t-shirts, if you can call t-shirts hardware, but where people would compete and the winning designs would actually be on t-shirts that got made. And so he told his general, that he was working for at the time, I have this idea. I want to open source hardware, and I want to do it in cars. And the rest is sort of the story I'm going to tell you now. So Jay felt this obligation to be great, and we do at Local Motors. And part of what our mission is to use less oil, and part of it's to make cars safer. This should never happen. We laugh, but we took that picture in India like 2 months ago. And I think that I saw a stat recently that the leading cause of death between like 16 or 18 and 37 year olds, don't quote me on the exact, but it is car accidents. I'll look that up and get it right. But I wasn't aware. So we, you know, when Jay was thinking about this, you know, and as we've gotten into the digital manufacturing realm, we realize if you can fix the complexity of the system, you can fix everything. So our first 3D printed car has 50 components. So we think of it as an accessory where you're just assembling the technology, you're printing to the technology, and then you're assembling the technology. And as we went back to the drawing board, what really sort of, as we thought through how to define this company, what was going to make us different, we weren't going to ever be able to compete with 100 years of scale manufacturing. But the way we looked at it was, what would Henry Ford have done differently if the internet existed when he founded the company? And as I mentioned, Siemens PLM has been a big part of that, because early on they saw what we were doing by trying to attract a global crowd, bringing them into the process digitally and physically, and carrying that all the way through our manufacturing. So the two parts of our business are co-creation, which we've talked a little bit about, and micromanufacturing. Co-creation is people who don't work for us around the world who we pay if we use their ideas, pay royalty to. And most of them don't compete or participate because they're looking to make money. Most of them participate because they're a 23-year-old student and they have a great idea, or they've just retired and they have great skills, or just peer review or recognition. On the second side, micromanufacturing, we can make 3,000 units a year in microfactories that are about the size of an American grocery store, so 50,000 square feet. This is the first car we designed. We'll talk about it in a second, but about 7,000 people contributed to it. It's the Rally Fighter. It's sort of what made us famous at the beginning. You may have seen it in the latest Transformers movie or the upcoming Fast and the Furious movies, but we made 100 of them and profitable at the 60th unit, meaning we can just develop something, make it, if it's not the right thing, move on to something else and not lose money on it. I like this picture because it reminds me that it's not just individuals that are participating with us, it's companies that are co-creating with us. We're giving you the box and asking you to fill it well before an OEM would do it. We're not keeping it secret. We're saying we're trying to do X, and you know, we need 1, 2, and 3 to make it happen. Do you have something that fits? And so the Lego thing for me really speaks to me because we're just pulling different components off the shelf in many cases and integrating new technologies. These are some of our contributors who have been the lead designers of vehicles we've produced and who make royalties for those vehicles. Second part, as we talked about, is micromanufacturing. This was actually last week, we printed a sign for our new microfactory in Knoxville that somebody came in and designed, you know, out in our lab area with with solid edge. These are some of our microfactories around the United States. Phoenix, Vegas, Knoxville, Phoenix, Vegas, and Louisville are represented here. You see the first build one is actually for GE. So we've taken this from vehicles to home appliances for GE, this co-creation and micromanufacturing model. What you see here is like in a microfactory most days. It's like a Willy Wonka in the chocolate factory. It's a circus atmosphere where we're trying to engage people. We're trying to get the local community in with their best ideas. Some areas where we've opened up, call it industrial tourism, where it's almost like you used to go and buy the Hard Rock t-shirt. Now you come to buy the microfactory t-shirt and say you've been there. But it's always exciting. You never know what's going on, what projects are being worked on before you head over to the microfactory. If you look at the traditional automotive industry, it takes about 7 years, sometimes a little less. Some companies have gotten down to about 5 from the time they start conceiving of a vehicle they might make and going out to suppliers and materials providers to bring it to market. And it's sort of this horizontal chain at the top. What Local Motors has done, and we've done it, I think we're finally starting to be able to do it on a repetitive basis, is if the LM, the blue LM in the middle there, down on the bottom left, if that's our microfactory, we're basically bringing in the customer into the facility, right? So they're buying locally. We are bringing third-party logistics right in there, so we're bringing the supply to build the inventory. We don't make inventory, but to build the product there. And we're sort of bringing tier one and tier two into the co-creation of the vehicle before we know what the vehicle is. And so everybody is convening at different microfactories around the world. So in Knoxville, for instance, where we're 3D printing cars, that's right next to Oak Ridge National Lab, who we worked with on that technology, and right next to the IACME, the Institute for Advanced Composites. I think the best composites work in the world is being done there, and we've been around to see a lot of good work. In Berlin, where we're building, we're focused on mechatronics. And these different labs we have within the microfactories that are open to local businesses, each has a different area of expertise, and those are networked. You know, it used to be that if you were an artisan or you were making something, you had to start, as everyone in this room knows so well, you had to draw it and pass that knowledge down to somebody who trained for a long time. And as CAD came along and when Siemens came to us, it made it a lot easier to bring people into our community digitally. And it made it a lot easier to bring them in with different file types. It was critical for us because not everybody had the same software. So this is our first car that I talked about earlier, the Rally Fighter. It's a beast, and it's Guinness World Record, world first crowdsourced car. I always laugh about that because it's like, who else would try to go for that? Like, there was nobody else was trying that, and everyone said it wasn't possible, but we did it in about a year, which was unheard of. And this is the so what factor of the whole presentation, I would say. We can bring vehicles to market or other complex mechanical devices at about 5 times faster and about 1/100 the cost. So 5 times faster being the left middle is cost versus some other examples. And then it's because we bring so many more people to the problem with different expertise. With enough eyeballs, all bugs are shallow. What's not on here, and what people from Tesla or BMW often come up to me and say after presentations like this is, I get it, but you can't make 1 million units. And I always say, yes, but But that's sort of the point. We don't need to. We don't need to build a billion-dollar facility and then amortize the cost over many years on the same units. That's why you guys will never have a navigation system that's better than the navigation system on my phone. Now you do, because we can use apps in the car. But the point, from a hardware perspective, if we talk about LiDAR, if we talk about sensors, you're not going to be able to keep up with the, if you're building vehicles on this cycle time. The other cool thing we do is, in a world of IoT, and because we're open, we host hackathons on our vehicles all the time, and we're collecting data as the consumers are using them. So because we're making, we don't keep inventory, and we're making each unit once it's bought, each unit can be better than the last. And people often ask about crash, and I'm not talking about changing crash dynamics with each vehicle or something that would affect. I'm talking about any host of other things. I put this slide in here because soon after we did the Ridefighter, we took this digital capability on the road to show that you could make a car out of the back of a trailer. Took it to the White House, took it all over the country. The next iteration of that is here. As we started to be outside of vehicles, we rebranded our co-creation effort called Forth. And so there's a trailer here that is a smaller version of this. So stop by, join the community, learn a little bit more about what we do. So getting back to sort of the theme here, we don't prototype, we don't manufacture, we sit in the sweet spot. People, you know, some Wall Street analysts will say, these guys are gonna be a prototyping shop when they mature. And some people say, you guys can't compete if you're not a mass manufacturer. And this is sort of our answer. If you look at, this is a cost curve. Mass manufacturers have the the circular, the rounded parabola there. if they make 1,000 units of something, it's going to be at really high cost. So they're always trying to get down to with each marginal unit, or with each unit, marginal cost is lower down in the end where it says more units. If you start with the same unit cost from unit number one, as you see the dotted line across, what you get is a blue sky area that isn't really accessible. And if you multiply, to a mass manufacturer, because it's a money-losing proposition for the most part, and we just multiply that 100 times over by microfactory. So what we think the future looks like is there's going to be a place for mass manufacturers. You're always going to have to bring the marginal cost of some good to zero because there's enough demand, but we think it's for fleets. And we think we will exist in a world of rapid technology integration. So soon after the Ridefighter, the DARPA came to us and said, Jay, you know, we know you started this because you were a Marine and had this issue. Can you help us, can the community help us design and deliver a vehicle for a specific region of Afghanistan that can go upwards of 100 miles an hour, can be up-armorable, and can evacuate 3 soldiers in full gear in the prone position? 3 months later, so that was delivered. We got to deliver it to the president, and it went over to Afghanistan for a cost, I think, of like $800,000, which is unheard of. The guy in the top left, Victor Garcia, he was the winning designer. He was an unemployed engineer in Detroit who was about to have a baby and couldn't pay the medical bills. Won the challenge, got to meet the president, got a job at Peterbilt, and then we ended up doing some work from Peterbilt. But that's the type of, Victor is very representative of the type of people who have success in our community. There's a reason they come, and they have skills, and what's happened since then has been pretty amazing. Then we got into intermodal transport. You know, there's very few companies in the world that make vehicles with 4 wheels and 2 wheels. It doesn't sound like a big deal. It is. And I only included this to say this is when we went from little 3D printing to bigger, so that the air intake, where you see the 16, that was 3D printed, and we started to really experiment. And then in 2014, we met the guys down at Oak Ridge National Lab, and this was our first 3D printed car, if you could play the video. We'll be right back. So it's a unibody, not a traditional chassis and body as you would think of, just one. And then if you saw the lattice structure that we were printing there, the honeycomb structure, that's what's helping us take crash. And we're testing it with various materials, both in the, I'll get to the materials in a second. John Hayes, am I okay on time? I just wanted to, there's a few more. Yes? Yeah, good. So launched that in 2014. It was a low-speed electric vehicle. This is the first highway car. So it took us 3 months to bring out the first 3D printed car, from people saying it's not possible to crowdsourcing the design and engineering of it to doing it. Also developing the machine to be able to do it to a place where it was capable. This took us a month and a half with this challenge to get a highway speed car going. Winning designer was Kevin Lowe, who worked for HP, who does work for HP. This has been exciting. This is the sort of interim step between the first 3D printed car and highway car. The vision is you'll walk into one of our facilities, walk up to a screen, choose your body, choose your powertrain. We're starting with electric and may, to be honest, never go anywhere else, but choose your tires, your wheels, your colors, your technologies. I want these sensors, or I want, you know, if you're a little bit more of a technophile, and then we print it while you wait, or you come back the next day to pick it up. It's first time that video I showed you took 44 hours. 3 months before that video in 2014, it was taking us 180 hours. Right now, we're well below 20 hours, and when it goes on sale to the public, we think we're going to be, our target's below 12 hours. But I think the sky's the limit because we're at the beginning of this technology. People often ask what it's made of. It's thermoplastic infused with carbon fiber for strength, but we're testing about 1,000 different mixes. And you know, just last week we started with graphene testing, when we're already showing some great strength improvement. It starts as pellets, and you infuse those pellets and you heat it up and extrude it. And then there's additive manufacturing, which is, you know, adding materials, top right there, and then subtractive, milling it to get a smooth surface. Those are three desktop printers, which most of us are familiar with from MakerBot. The cool thing about this technology is that same file you started in Solid Edge that with Siemens we're working through to go through the entire process to the made good. Kids are using in elementary school to print on desktop printers. And I always talk about this because it means, you know, whenever we're at a show or somewhere with our vehicles, it's never the parent that's like pulling the kid over to see the car. It's always like the kid pulling the parent saying, this is the 3D printed car. And it's great for the first time, I think, maybe in history, we got 8-year-olds and, you know, professors working in the same, on the same made thing, just a different scale. Just last couple slides here. I mentioned, so we do this in vehicles, but also companies like Airbus have come to us, and now we're putting a drone out with them. And GE, like I said, is we do their appliances, but now we just launched a sort of robotics in their measurement and controls division. And so we make money both from that consulting, like how do you do this, but also on every unit that gets produced in those verticals for them. And you may have seen the Domino's delivery vehicle. This was also a co-created project launched in a Super Bowl ad. This is the Airbus drone I was just talking about. It's pretty cool. It's a cargo drone. You'll be able to call it on an app. And then sort of finally, I hope this has shown that, like, together, you know, if, because it's not the people at Locomotors, it's the global community. Together, we build ideas unlike anyone can. I love this picture. I pulled it off Instagram. Siemens has been critical in getting our latest product to market. It's called Ali, and I'm just gonna sort of end with this video just to introduce you.
Hello, my name is Ali. And I'm making history.
This is a huge day in automotive history. Not only is it the day where Ford Motor Company was incorporated, June 16th, 1903, but also it's the day where we got people comfortable with the idea of riding around in a completely self-driving vehicle. I'm Jay Rogers, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Local Motors.
I am the first cognitively enabled vehicle. I seat 12 passengers. And you can ask me anything.
Ollie, why don't you say hello?
Hi, everyone. My name is Ollie. I'm a self-driving vehicle powered by IBM Watson technology. I can help people get around National Harbor.
Ollie, I'm hungry. Where can I get some food?
National Harbor has some great seafood. Would you like that?
That sounds great. What's good?
Well, then, try the Crab Cake Cafe.
All right. I'll go there for dinner.
Okay, but don't forget your umbrella. There is a severe thunderstorm warning tonight.
The sensor set on this vehicle allows us to be able to feed data to Watson and feed data back to Ollie to make life more enjoyable. Thanks, Ollie.
By the way, I like your bow tie.
I'm what's next in automotive innovation. I come from Jay and the engineers at Local Motors.
Local Motors is a technology company that it's here to revolutionize a 120-year history of the way that vehicles are made.
I still remember the first time someone told me about Local Motors and they said, well, we have a 3D printed car. And then I saw their vision in projects like Ollie.
You're going to see this shift. You're going to see the vehicles become more highly automated, ultimately autonomous. You're going to see vehicles become cognitive. And so Watson IoT Auto Lab is very much around the future of that cognitive experience.
Not all of the information, not all of the capability for the vehicle is now going to be on vehicle, be enhanced by things in the cloud.
And the best part, this is just a start. I'm about to go global.
By the end of the year, you'll see Ollie in Copenhagen, and you'll see him in Las Vegas. You'll see him in Miami-Dade County and several other places around the world.
I can create a platform for all developers to engage and shape the future of self-driving vehicles.
We co-create. It's our people and their people together, side by side, creating the future of cognitive mobility.
It was very exciting to us when IBM approached us and said, could we partner with you in putting Watson IoT into one of your vehicle sets, and could we do it quickly?
And you have to be able to ask questions, just like my passenger asks me, are we there yet? You can ask Ollie these same questions.
The world of IoT is moving at lightning speed. The only way to stay ahead of that game and to be a player in that game is to be able to innovate as quickly as possible, be able to assemble and deploy solutions as quickly as possible, and that's what Local Motors is trying to do, and that's definitely what IBM Watson IoT is doing.
We started on this project 3 months ago, and 3 months ago doesn't mean we made a prototype. We sold our first 10 Ollies today.
That's a dream, and it's possible because of all this technology.
Well, so long for now. My name is Ollie. It was sure nice to meet you.
So I'm sorry for the long video, and that wasn't supposed to be an advertisement for IBM at a Siemens event. What that was supposed to be was showing you that Solid Edge is the front door, that the work we're doing allows us as a community to integrate new technologies a lot more quickly today, whether it's IBM Watson or Amazon Alexa or Velodyne sensors or somebody else. So that's what I'm just trying to highlight. I guess John asked me about calls to action. I would say first, it's a big deal that Siemens is doing Solid Edge for startups. And so I hope people in this crowd will apply if you need it, or you'll tell people to get involved. I think I can proudly say I think Local Motors is a conspirator in the sense of we want everybody to get involved, and allowing people to have this capability to in the design and engineering process is critical. And I think that this community represents the tip of the spear of what will be happening in the future. And the other thing is go buy our fourth trailer, get involved with our community. We'd love to have you. I'll be here all day if anyone has questions. I know that was a lot to cover, but thanks for having me.